Hand over to the lovely Joanna, and she is going to introduce herself and start today's webinar. Oh, I can't hear you, Joanna. I think you might be on mute still.
Okay, can you hear me now? All
There we go, yes.
right, so we should be pretty good to go. Here we go. Better get here for a second. All right, so hi everyone. My name is Johanna. I'm actually half American, half Icelandic, so you won't be hearing much of an Icelandic accent from me today. I have worked for Iceland Travel for over 16 years. I'm mainly in the groups department, but also a little bit of FIT. I was also in incentives for a short time when I first started. I am the mother of a teenage girl, which is fun sometimes, not so fun sometimes. I'm sure some of you know that. My favorite place in Iceland is in the south, in particular, two places that are very hike friendly, a place called Fakil and then another place called Þórsmörk. And as you can see in that top picture there, I'm hiking. I believe it was Þórsmörk a couple years ago. I do want to point out that I don't normally hike with a pink cowboy hat on. That was just a fun experience for that time. So anyway, tourism for me is helping people make amazing, even life-changing experiences. And I've been doing it for a while and I really love it. So just a little bit about Iceland for some of you that don't know anything about the country. I do have a few slides about Iceland. This is what the country looks like. If you look at the bottom left-hand corner there, where it looks like a boot is kind of shooting out, kind of a laying flat, it is the Reykjanes Peninsula, and that is where you're going to find the Keflavik Airport, the international airport, right on the toe almost. And from there, it is about a 30-45 minute drive into Reykjavik, which is where we sit today. It's a relatively large island just south of the Arctic Circle. It is about 103,000 square kilometers in the size, which is similar to, for my European people out there, Hungary or Portugal, if you know your countries. And for Americans, it's about the size of Kentucky, if you guys have an idea of what those states or that state looks like. It is the second largest island of Europe after Great Britain. So just a little bit of more fun facts here about Iceland. The population is about 375,000 people that have about two-thirds of them are living in Reykjavik. So the Reykjavik is the biggest city. The currency is the Icelandic kroner, where 1 euro today is about 153 Icelandic kroner, and a dollar is about 138 Icelandic kroner. We are on the Greenwich Mean Time year-round. We do not change our clocks. Language is Icelandic, but everyone, and I'm saying literally almost everyone here speaks English. They speak it well. Icelanders are very friendly. They love to practice their English with you. Iceland is a very peaceful country. And as many of you know, it's kind of like Alaska with the daylight hours. We have the midnight sun in the summertime, and then we have the northern lights in the wintertime. And the northern lights, of course, can be seen from about, I'd say late August to about April 15th. So it really has to be dark out. So you're not going to see them in those main summer months because of all the light we have. So talking about the daylight hours, here is a slide with information on that. I don't want to scare any of you off with those temperatures in June and July, though it does say 12, 14 degrees or in your 50s for the Americans. It does get hotter than that in a lot of places in Iceland. It really depends on the summer. This summer in Reykjavik wasn't that great, but it was great up north where they did see, temperatures in the 20s or in the 70s. Iceland, of course, is not considered to be a very warm place, but people don't necessarily come here for the weather. But thanks to the Gulf Stream, we do have a pretty moderate climate, I'd say, year-round. I can tell you that Reykjavik, for the most part, in the winter doesn't even see a crazy amount of snow. Now, that's just Reykjavik. We do have snow up in the north and in the fjords in the west and the east fjords, but in Reykjavik for the most part it is pretty mild, mild winters. So I'm just going to show you a quick slide on the airlines that fly to and from Reykjavik or Iceland. You've got Iceland Air and Play, which are your Iceland airlines, and then of course all these other ones that I'm sure many of you recognize. That a second. Here's Iceland Air's route map. Now, Iceland Air is the largest Icelandic-owned airline, with Keflavik obviously being its hub. We've got about 14 U.S. Or Canadian destinations, 35 European destinations. We've got four in Greenland and four domestic within Iceland. That's a little bit about Iceland Air. And then we have Play, which is our low-cost airline. You're going to see about 30 cities there in Europe, and you've got the four in the United States plus Toronto in Canada. So these are options. If we go into a little bit about Iceland Travel, we were founded in about 1936. The staff at Iceland Travel is anywhere between 90 to about 120, depending on the season. Obviously, quite a bit more in the summertime than in the winter. Most people are that I work with here are very well educated within the industry. They even speak, three plus languages. I thought I was coming in here pretty smooth with my two, Icelandic and English, and that got shot out of the water with the people here speaking quite a bit more than me. We are the largest DMC in Iceland, and that's because we have a MICE department. We have a cruise department that handles over 50% of the cruise liners that come to Iceland. We've got a groups department. We've got the FIT that has the escorted tours and self-drives, and we've got tailor-made department that will provide any kind of private itineraries for you with a private driver guide. Then we have our Nine Worlds department, which is kind of the super high-end luxury clientele. So that's a little bit about the different departments. Iceland Travel is a member of both domestic and international associations. As you can see here, we have associations with the United States Tour Operators Association, Signature, the European Tour Operators Association, and the Japan Association of Tour Operators. So that's just to name a few. So if we go into the services that we provide, we have escorted tours. Now we've got those in the winter and in the summer. Different lengths of time. We have different group sizes. So we have a small group, which is no more than 16 people. And then we've got our classic large group, which is no more than about 36. All tours are operated with licensed and specialized suppliers. We handpick our guides for all these different tours. Accommodation, we always include breakfast. We have quality accommodation with private bathrooms. We include dinners in the countryside. And the dinners always have an emphasis on the local ingredients in each of the regions. We offer 24/7 emergency assistance for FITs and people coming here with groups. Pretty much anyone that Iceland Travel does any kind of service with, we do provide that emergency assistance number. So we have self-drives. Again, we have these in the winter. We've got them in the summer, different lengths of time. You can choose the different type of cars. We have accommodation, again, with the breakfast included. We've got, again, different types of vehicles. We've got the insurance included, unlimited mileage, GPS, theft protection, additional driver. We include that at no extra charge. Pickup and drop off at the airport for your client's convenience. Again, we've got that emergency phone number to call 24 hours if people are in need. Self-drive packages also come with the Iceland Travel pop-up guide, which is an app. And this pop-up guide is it's an app that they can download on three different devices. And this app is going to show them their itinerary, where they have their hotels, where their hotels are at, phone numbers. If they have anything booked, it's going to have that information as far as activities. It's going to have the where they're at, phone numbers. The one thing it doesn't do, and a lot of people confuse this, is it's not like Google Maps where they can put in their location and put in, I want to go to Dettifoss waterfall, and it's not going to take you there. It's going to show you where you are and what points of interest and museums and stuff like that are around you, but you can't navigate with it. So that's just something that we have to tell people because I guess that confuses some of our guests. City breaks, okay, we have them year round, again, like everything else. Now, these city breaks are going to be anywhere from a 2 to 4 day. We can have them theme based with maybe spa and culture or adventure and activity, northern lights based. Typical short break package is going to maybe include some kind of food walk, a Golden Circle tour, or a South Shore tour, which is meaning a full day, maybe 8, 10 hour tour. And then we're going to have maybe the Sky Lagoon or the Blue Lagoon. And then the rest of the time, just people at leisure in Reykjavik, looking at museums or just walking around on their own, going to cafes and pubs and eating great food. But that's a little bit about our city breaks. With tailor-made itineraries, now this is going to be more flexibility. So if you have clients that have this the kind of budget for private, it's great. You know, it's our private, you know, it's definitely something that we don't see. It's going to going away anytime soon because of the flexibility, and we're just seeing that that's what people are kind of after these days. Our tailor-made department will give you a private guided tour, whether it's a day tour or multi-day tour, anywhere from 1 to 9 packs. And the same thing with the nine worlds. They do provide that type of service as well. So again, if people are looking for more flexibility, this is pretty much what they're gonna want to book. So with the virtual fam, we're gonna take you on the Iceland Complete tour, and I do have a video here after this slide that is gonna show you a little bit about the tour, but I will go into a day-to-day more detail after the video. So okay, small technical difficulties. So just a quick review of that, what you just kind of saw. Departures are offered all year in the summertime. This tour is a 10-day, 9-night, while in the winter it is 1 day shorter, so 9 days, 8 nights. Again, we have small group, which is no more than 16 people, and our classic or large group is going to be 36. We do have quality tour vehicles. We have licensed and handpicked guides, good accommodation, breakfast included. Once again, dinners in the countryside for the most part are included. And again, that 24-hour emergency assistance, which we find to be very helpful for everyone coming to Iceland. So we just get into day one. I do want to start off by pointing out that we don't have the transfers included. But we can, of course, either book you a private transfer where you would have a private, you know, driver pick you up right when you enter the welcoming hall at the airport, or you just join a shared bus tour that will take you into the city. So either one we can obviously arrange. If you arrive early on this day one, we do suggest that you possibly do a day tour or go to one of our geothermal swimming pools. There's plenty of them all throughout the city. You do have to keep in mind that check-in is not until about between 2 and 4 p.m., depending on the hotel. So you're going to want to try to keep yourself busy. Specifically, my U.S. friends coming from America, the flights land a lot of the time between, you know, 6 and 7 a.m. So they're going to want to do something to keep themselves awake after that red-eye flight. So that's just a little bit about day one. And you will meet the guide for an informational meeting in the evening at the hotel. So that's where you'll learn more about the tour and meet your fellow travelers basically for the tour. So day two is when you're going to leave Reykjavik and you're going to go into the countryside. And this first day is basically our Golden Circle tour. The first stop is normally Þingvellir National Park. Now, I do want to point out that we do reserve the right to make any changes to these days, just depending on any kind of road conditions or weather conditions that may have to basically have us do that. So that's just something to point out. So the national park at Þingvellir, it has been a national park since about 1930, and it is also a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Now that's since 2004. And Þingvellir holds both historic interest as well as geology appeal. Now, at Þingvellir is where you're going to find the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, where the North American tectonic plate and the Eurasian tectonic plate are drifting apart from each other. And they drift apart at about 2 centimeters a year. And into this, it's kind of creating this kind of rift valley, which is pretty cool to see, especially for anybody interested in geology. Þingvellir is also where the parliament was created. Now, that was back in 930, and parliament actually convened there until the late 17, early 1800s. So another stop on this day is going to be in the geyser area, where you're going to see one of the geysers spout hot water up about 30 meters or 100 feet into the air every few minutes. And you're also going to see Gullfoss waterfall, which is known as the Golden Waterfalls. One of the most popular tourist attractions in Iceland, I'd say. It has water that cascades down into two stages, one at 11 meters high and the other one at 20, 21 meters high. And they cascade down into this basically 2.5 kilometer long crevice, which is pretty neat to see. We also have included on this day a stop at the Friðheimar tomato greenhouse, geothermal greenhouse. And there your guests will get a taste of Icelandic tomatoes that are made in the greenhouse year round. So that is that day two. So day three, we're focusing on all the amazing sites in the south of Iceland. And some of these sites include Seljalandsfoss waterfall and Skógafoss waterfall. And now behind Seljalandsfoss waterfall, which I don't have a picture of there, you can actually walk behind the falls, which is really neat. For any of you movie buffs out there, a lot of films have been filmed in this area. Those include Star Wars Rogue One, The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, Prometheus, Thor, and let's not forget the Eurovision Song Contest movie, The Story of Fire Saga. And then, of course, Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones was filmed in a lot of places in Iceland. So, for you movie buffs, this is definitely a place to come to see these different sites. Dyrhólaey, which is that picture in the left corner there, that's an area in the summertime where you're going to find puffins. They're going to be around from about mid-May to beginning of August. And you kind of, the guide really knows when they're there. They're there either early in the morning or in the later part of the evening, around 4 or 5. And the rest of the time, they're just out in the ocean, you know, fishing for food. So, yeah, that's a little bit about that. And then you've got the black sand beaches around Vík. And on this night, you're staying in the Vík area with, again, dinner included. So the next day is going to be kind of a world of glaciers. You'll be visiting the southern area of Vatnajökull National Park, named after the Europe's largest glacier, which is Vatnajökull. You're also going to go to the Glacier Lagoon, and there you're going to see in that top picture there, you're going to see big chunks of icebergs kind of floating in the water. It's absolutely beautiful. On this day, you're going to stay overnight in a town called Höfn, which is a kind of a fishing village, fishing port town. Again, dinner is going to be included this evening. And just a little bit about Vatnajökull Glacier. It is Europe's largest glacier. It covers more than 8% of the country. And it's also where Iceland's highest mountain, Öræfajökull, is located in this area. So Vatnajökull is now a national park as well, and that was established in 2008. And with the glacier itself and the park, it covers about 14% of Iceland, making it Western Europe's largest national park. So that's a little bit about that. Heading on to the east and into the east fjords of Iceland. Now, East Iceland is home to about 13,000 Icelanders, most of them living in the unofficial capital of the east called Egilsstaðir. The town is called Egilsstaðir. Today, you're going to pass through fjords and villages, each with its own kind of special charm and history. For example, Fáskrúðsfjörður. This is a fjord that was settled long ago by French seamen. They built houses there, they built a hospital there. And today, that actual hospital and the houses have been changed into a hotel and museum that is basically dedicated to this French history in the area. And actually, some of the signs are both in French and in Icelandic in this small little town, which is kind of neat. Today you're going to visit a microbrewery, and your guests will have the chance to sample some local beer there. In East Iceland, they are known for wild reindeer. So if you are lucky or your clients are lucky, they will see wild reindeer running around. That's really neat. in this area, we have one of Iceland's only forest. It's called a Hallormsstaðarskógur. And try to say that a couple times in a row. Otherwise, Iceland is pretty bare of trees. It's really kind of in this area where we have an actual forest. So the day ends in that town, Egilsstaðir, which is the unofficial capital of the East. And again, dinner is included on this night. So we're going to keep going around the circle. We're going to head towards Lake Mývatn area of Iceland. In this area, you're going to find Dettifoss waterfall, which is Europe's mightiest waterfall. And that's the picture of it right there. And if you're driving towards it, you're going to see like the spray of the water, like a couple kilometers away because of how mighty it is, basically. The view is spectacular and it's unobstructed. There's no boardwalks or viewing platforms, just a massive waterfall in its natural environment. So it's really amazing to see. You're going to see a Námaskarð Pass, which is a geothermal area with boiling mud pools and vibrant colors. You're going to see the lava formations of Dimmuborgir, which is a picture there in the right, top right. And that is definitely interesting. It looks like fantasy creatures almost built them. Some of the rocks there reach about 20 meters in height or 65 feet. Hverafjall crater is another stop in the area. And this is a 396 meter high tephra explosion craters. It is located near the eastern shore of Lake Mývatn. So then we're going to be stopping at pseudo craters at Skútustaðir. And also a really neat stop is at a place called Grjótagjá, where it's a cave, but inside the cave, there's a hot spring. Now, for any of you Game of Thrones fans out there, I believe there was a scene with two of the main characters bathing in this hot spring. So that was there, which is pretty neat. So needless to say, as I mentioned, Game of Thrones, this area is really big with Hollywood for scenes in all kinds of movies. So dinner and overnight in Lake Mývatn on this night. So now we're going to head towards Akureyri, which is Iceland's second largest city with about 19,000 people that live there. Between Mývatn and Akureyri, we're going to stop at that waterfall, those two pictures up at the top there. That is the waterfall of the gods, or Goðafoss, as we say in Icelandic. So afterwards, you will head to Akureyri, which is a very colorful northern capital. The town has charming buildings, a beautiful view of Eyjafjörður fjord. You can kind of see that in that picture in the bottom right. So the rest of the day there is going to be at leisure for people in this small town. This is the only night in the program as well where people will be dining on their own because there is a lot to choose from. People can also just stroll the streets. There are museums, there's pubs and cafes. There's a botanical garden that's, open year round. So there's a lot you can see in this cute little quaint town. Again, the dinner is going to be on your own on this night. So then we're going to head to Skagafjörður and Borgarnes. Now, this part of Iceland is known for its horse breeding. Today, guests actually get a real pretty neat treat with an introduction to the Icelandic horse. So a stop is made where they get to see horses. There's going to be like a horse show where they show people how Icelandic horses have a different gait. They have a fifth gait that not all other horses have. So that'll be a show, and there's refreshments provided as well. Today there'll be a stop at Deildartunguhver, which is Europe's largest hot spring, which is that picture on the top left. And then you're going to see some more waterfalls on this day. That's Hraunfossar and Barnafoss down at the bottom there. And then you're going to stay overnight in the Borgarfjörður area with dinner included on this night. So on day nine, we're going to have our last kind of sightseeing day before ending the day back. The sights include the Snæfellsjökull Glacier. You've got black pebble beaches. We have sea cliffs with bird life, and that's kind of mainly in the summertime, and quaint fishing villages throughout. You're going to explore the amazing variety of natural landscapes in Snæfellsjökull. There's a national park there. With the crown's jewel is the Snæfellsjökull Glacier. You're going to see the most photographed mountain in Iceland, which is that one in the top right corner where the northern lights are. It's called Kirkjufell. That's the most photographed mountain in Iceland. You're going to walk by Djúpalónssandur Beach, which is a pebble beach, and visit the picturesque harbor town of Arnarstapi. A stop is going to be made at a shark museum called Bjarnarhöfn. Well, you'll learn about I think it's the Greenlandic shark that, I think Vikings back in the day cured this shark meat. And Icelanders actually still eat it today. And if you dare, your clients will get a taste of it, of cured shark meat. It's something you'll never forget. And then we're back in Reykjavik for this night with dinner on your own. And this is the last night. So that's when you would be saying goodbye to your guide. So again, we do not have transfers included. So on this last day, depending on when your flight is, you may have some time to, walk around Reykjavik in the morning. But we would either have to book you a private transfer or get you on a shared coach transfer, just depending on what your clients are looking for. So why Iceland Travel? Just a little bit about us. We are a one-stop shop. We do everything from FIT to any kind of customized groups to incentive tours. We've had the tailor-made, and then we have your super high-end clientele, which is Nine Worlds. We do a lot of group tours with groups that are going on cruise. So if they want to do something pre or post cruise, we do a lot of work with that. We are fully licensed with the tourist board. We hold all the necessary insurances. We are very environmentally conscious. We utilize professional guides that have, deep knowledge of Iceland's history, culture, natural environment. And of course, we have those well-informed sales representatives that have been in the industry for a long time and have a lot of experience in the industry, well-educated. And again, they speak, three, four languages much more than I do. Again, a little bit about the responsible traveling. We are certified by Travel Life. So that's just a little bit about that. Trying to be responsible here with tourism. So again, we provide that 24-hour emergency assistant the entire time your clients are in Iceland. We are quick with email response, and we have a customer service department. We now have a self-drive price calculator on our website, which is something new. So you can go on our website and kind of choose the vehicle you think your clients would want, how many days they want to stay, and you get a price for that. So you can kind of, look at this on your own instead of having to be in constant contact with us. We have an agent login where people can find, high-res photos. They can find past webinars, sample itineraries, price list. All this can be found if you're, in under our agent login. We are on social media, so we have a Twitter account, we have Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn. We have videos on YouTube, so you can really find us all over the place. And here we have a quick video about Iceland travel.
Back in the day, when tourists were called explorers, Iceland Travel was already at their service. Today, our guests benefit from our decades of learning because each trip has taken a century of connections to build. Living in Iceland gives us insight, a uniquely local perspective, which helps us to make the experience more enjoyable through seamless local service. Iceland is more than a travel destination. It is also our home. And we believe in caring for our home by keeping it nice and clean so that everyone can enjoy Iceland in the same way our first visitors did almost a century ago. We make the most of your trip because we're local.
Okay, so that is just a little bit about us. So again, who we are, what we stand for. Iceland Travel was founded in 1936. So for almost 100 years now, we've been proudly serving the diverse needs of clients from all over the world. So every day our experts are on the ground and they try to craft these unforgettable travel experience, for your guests, and making everything very unique, making these local journeys for them. And this is why we are the leading B2B travel company in Iceland. Able to care for your guests in the best possible way that we can. So that's what we do at Iceland Travel. And that is pretty much it for me today. Hope you guys got a lot out of that. I know I talk fast. I apologize for that.
Thank you, Johanna. That was a brilliant presentation. We have had some questions that have come through. Could you please just stop sharing your screen, Johanna?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you very much. So we've had quite a few questions that have come in. So let's go through some of those. A question from Sandra is, do you find that a lot of families travel to Iceland? She's noticed that there's a minimum age of 8. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is for our some of our tours. We do still get a lot of families that travel to Iceland. Iceland is, very family for we're very it's a very safe country. There's plenty to do here with kids. There's, all kinds of swimming pools with slides in them. And but yeah, for escorted tours, it is the minimum age is 8, just because there's all kinds of other people joining the tours. And yeah, so for but I mean that's not it's not a problem. We've had multi-gen, groups together. So we've got maybe a big group of a family traveling together. That would be something that I would put together because I'm more in the groups department. So anything more than 10 people is considered a group. So then it's real easy to customize anything for families with really kids of any age.
Perfect, thank you. And a question from Jacqueline. Can you accommodate physically challenged clients or clients that have mobility requirements?
We that can sometimes be difficult, but we've just have to, reach out to our coach services and try to find, which ones have the best. If there's any kind of wheelchair, accessibility, if we're looking at that, I know that's something that we can definitely look into. I don't not sure how much we've done that, but it's that's definitely not a problem. And if people just have, like, say, a walker or a cane, then that's not an issue at all to put like the walker underneath the coach and get it out each time for guests that need it. That's something that our guides would help with, and even the drivers would help with. So, yeah.
Perfect. Thank you. Lots of agents have been asking for a copy of the webinar. We do record it, so I will share that with Johanna. And when the team do the follow up, they can include that link for everybody to have that and save that information. So don't worry, we will send it to you. Another question is there swimming allowed at the hot spring stops, or are they environmentally protected?
The hot springs. Well, I mean, we have these geothermal hot, like the Blue Lagoon is considered to be one, and then there's one in the north called the Nature Bass. Those are baths that people can bathe in. There's another one in the east called Vuk. There is one in Akureyri called the Forest Lagoon. So these are all also geothermal, hot springs. The natural ones that people, if they're doing self drives, they kind of can stumble upon. A lot of them are available to anyone. It's just some of them are on private land, so maybe some people aren't really thrilled with people just kind of jumping out of their cars and going for a dip in these things. But for the most part, they are open to really anyone. So.
Thank you. And a question from Jane. Are these itineraries posted on the website, or where can they find some more details and information?
That's all on our website.
All on
Yeah.
the website.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
And a question from Katie. Which day is omitted during the winter months?
They go the whole s that's a good question. I can't remember which day they skip. I believe they may I have to check on that. You
I
mean like
think
it.
it might be in the north, actually, or the east.
Yeah. I would have to check on that and get back to you. I'm not exactly sure which day drops off there. That's a good question. I should know that. It's either in the north or the east, as my colleague is telling me here. Yeah.
No problem. We can include that in the follow-up. Not a
Yeah.
problem. Thank
Yeah.
you. Somebody's asking what is peak season and when is shoulder season?
So peak season is going to be your June, July, August, even into September. September is now considered a pretty high season month. Shoulder would then be, October and May are kind of shoulder months, and then the rest are low season. But it's almost hard to call them low season anymore, because even, February, November, some of January, because of the northern light season, and that's when the northern lights, they're out in the winter months. It's those seasons have just become so popular with us now that it's hard to determine what's exactly low season and shoulder and high, just because of how the northern lights have become so popular. But I would say for the most part, yes, high season is still your June, July, August, September. May and October, shoulder season, and then the rest are kind of lower season.
Thank you. And a question from a few agents on how billing works. So if an agent is going to book a tour through you, is that commissionable and how would payment terms work with an agent?
We do have our rates are pretty much net, but we do have discounted rates. So we would, talk to your agents about that with a follow-up, what is discounted. So it just depends on what it is. If it's an escorted tour, self-drive, day tour, that there's just different percentages to what is discounted. For the most part, we can wire transfer. So we would get a payment, we send a payment link. If there is commission, then we just ask for all the bank information, all the information that we need to be able to wire transfer back, and that's how we make the payment back with commission. But we do send payment links. That's how we,
Brilliant.
yeah.
That's quite, brilliant. A question from Kim. She's got some clients that are interested, but they're a little bit worried to visit due to the recent volcanic activity, and should they be concerned?
That's always a good question. We've had seven eruptions, I think, in the past year. They've all been in the same area of where, basically, not all that far from the Blue Lagoon, but in that part of the Reykjanes Peninsula, which, in all honesty, is only about a 40-45 minute drive from us. But it's not anything that has affected our lives whatsoever. It did when the first eruption started, a little over a year ago. It did affect one tiny town, which basically they had to close that town, but that's the only area or only thing that has been affected since all these eruptions. I mean, there's been no effect on any kind of air, the airplanes, anything like that, landing issues, nothing like that. Our tours have been going, even the Blue Lagoon, which is not all that far from where these eruptions have taken place, has remained open. So it's not affecting our lives whatsoever, to tell you the truth. And a lot of times it's just an attraction. Like, people, can drive by on one of the main roads, and they can see it, and it's a pretty neat thing to see. So as for right now, it's really nothing to worry about. And we do send out, when there is an eruption, anything from our, the government and these agencies that are keeping an eye on this, they let us know what's going on, and we try to get that information out to the agents as soon as we get it. So we do keep you posted on what's going on.
Brilliant, thank you. A lot of the questions that have come in are quite specific in terms of pricing and itineraries. So for questions like that, I will allow for the agents to contact you directly once you've done a follow-up because they're very specific questions.
We can send
So
price lists out, or people can join that agent login. If they just, go online and sign up for the agent login, then they could get all the price lists that we have listed. So
brilliant. And you've got an amazing sales team, obviously, to assist if there's questions as
yeah,
well that come up from
absolutely.
the
Yeah.
agents.
Yeah.
Lovely. Thank you so much, Johanna. So now it's time for the question to ask the agents. So they get very excited for this. So if all of the agents could please go to the chat screen and make sure again that your drop down says everybody. You know how this works now, but the person who answers the question correctly the quickest will win 10 points into the spin to win prize draw. So everybody will get 1 point for simply joining the webinar today. And whoever gets that correct will have 10 points that I will leave with Sarah for when she's back to handle. So, if everyone's ready at the chat function, Johanna, could you please let us know what prize you're actually giving away today? And then go ahead with your question, please.
Hold on just a minute. I'm just talking to my colleague here, who's involved in this with me.
Hi, everyone. We're going to be giving out the gift certificate with Amazon. So, should we ask the question?
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah, so I'll just clarify on that part. So, depending on where the travel agent lives, it will be paid in pounds, euros, or dollars,
Exactly.
depending on where you are in the world. So, yes, please go ahead and ask your question.
So we wanted to ask, what is the best season to come and visit Iceland for the Northern Lights? When will you see them?
It moves so fast.
I was going to say it's really fast over there.
Really fast. So, winter is the correct answer, right?
Yeah.
So, the first agent to say that was Angela. So, well done, Angela. And lots of you got that right, actually. So, well done, everybody. But very important because your clients are definitely going to ask you that question when they can see the Northern Lights. Winter it is indeed. Okay, well, thank you so much, Johanna, and everybody in the team for coming on today. We really appreciate you sharing and inspiring the travel agents with some Iceland itineraries. And obviously, you'll do the follow-up for those agents that were asking. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining. And that's all from us. Have a lovely day, everybody.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
See you later.
Bye.
Bye.